Hey folks, Ontario Gardener here. I just want to introduce this video to you. Going to show you what happened from start to finish with my tomatoes last year. 2020 was a different year. I wasn't planning on making a garden last year just because of our land wasn't ready and we hadn't had a fence up yet, we didn't have our gardens put up yet or anything, and it really wasn't something that I had planned for the summer of 2020. However, with all the changes and things that happened last year, we changed course and we put things under construction, we got the fence up and raised beds built, and we got soil in, a lot of things to put everything together. Now, when I was planting the tomatoes, it was already April, and I thought, okay, so usually if I'm going to start my seeds, I start my tomatoes in March, early to mid-March. And the reason why you do that is that so the plants are mature enough when you put them into the ground in June, that they're mature enough to give you a harvest, you know, mid-summer, in the middle of summer, towards the end of summer. So what happened with mine is I went ahead and I started my seedlings the beginning of April, and I'm going to show you the progression of how my plants did. There's a couple of different issues that I had. I planted some Roma tomato seeds that I've had since from my 2012 videos. Now, the Roma tomatoes usually only are about this big when they're mature, and they're a smaller tomato, and I wanted to plant tomatoes for sauce, so I wanted some Romas for sauce, and so you need a large amount of tomatoes to make sauce, and I also wanted some slicing tomatoes, some beefsteak, so I planted Brandywine. And then I also do a couple of grape tomato plants because, you know, little salad tomatoes and salsa and things like that. And they're usually the ones that are ready first. The smaller the tomato, the earlier your harvest. So the grape tomatoes are great for that. So if tomatoes aren't mature enough when you plant them in June, if you're planting them too late, then come September, you can get frost in September very easily, and that is what happened to us last year. Is we ended up with frost warnings in by the middle of September, which is not something we get usually until October. So when you have these plants and you're taking care of them for 4 to 5 months, the last thing you want done to happen is to have a frost that just comes and kills everything. Because once your plants are frozen, and once your tomatoes are frozen, there's no more ripening them. They're done. Yeah, and you can't bring them in to make sauce, nothing. They're just done. So it takes a lot of time and effort to get through the fall with making sure that you're going to get your harvest. So what happened was the beefsteak tomatoes, they did pretty well. Growing indoors in the seed with the seeds, so did the grape tomatoes. The Romas were small. I started them in May, and I wasn't sure if I was gonna have to buy seedlings in the store, and I don't really like doing that because I spend all this money on, you know, just on somebody else planting seedlings when I can do it myself. And then it's like, well, if I spend $10 on seedlings, why not just spend $10 on tomatoes throughout the summer? Anyways, so those Roma tomatoes that go into the ground, only a couple of them survived. Out of all of them that I planted out in June, only two of them survived. And I kept them in the garden growing. Probably the second week of June, I went to a nursery. I'd done some research, and I found out that a variety called San Marzano tomatoes are a Roma tomato, and they are an Italian variety, and they're greatly used for, you know, sauce, and they're very meaty and easy to grow. It ended up being that they're indeterminate, so they keep vining, and I found a nursery that still had some seedlings, some starts, because by that time, basically, your stores are sold out. Nobody really has specific varieties of plants left in the middle of June. So I went to a nursery, and she gave me this tray. It was like a dollar, I think. I think I had 8 seedlings, and they were tiny, tiny. They were about this big, and they were dried out, and they looked sickly. And she said, you know, these are really hardy plants, these San Marzanos, and if you take them and plant them and put them in, you know, good soil, take care of them, fertilize them, they'll take off growing. So I said, okay, I'll try them. What else could I do? There really wasn't anything else available. So I'll show you what happened with those plants. Keep in mind that they are about 6 weeks behind. So the growth and the fruit that I was getting in September, October is what I should have been getting in the middle of the summer. But I'm going to show you the whole progress of those plants. I don't know how vloggers do these videos all the time, because there's many times I'm out in the garden, I thought, oh, I should have recorded that, but I don't have my camera with me all the time, and I'm usually like in my pajamas doing gardening, and then there's noise outside, and you know, it takes a lot of time and effort to then edit everything when you bring them inside. So what I did was I saved all the clips from different videos that I did in the garden last year, put them all together for tomatoes, and I'm going to show you some different things that happened with our soil and some problems that we had. And then there's also a video that I'm going to do. It takes up too much time in this video, and I know this is going to be somewhat of a lengthy video to take you all the way through the season, but I did a specific video on pruning the tomatoes, and I'll do that one separately if you're interested. Anyways, I hope you enjoy this video and that, you know, it's somewhat educational so that you can see the progress of how large the plants got, how much volume I got off the plants, and basically we grew right until November, and finally it was like, okay, that's it, I'm done with tomatoes. I was bringing them inside to ripen once they got pink on the vines, and I was just ready to clean up my kitchen and my living area and no longer have, you know, tomatoes coming in November. So anyways, I hope you enjoy this video. Let me know if these kind of videos is something that you want to see. If there's interest, then I'll continue them. And I just hope you learned something from it and enjoy it. Thanks for stopping by and giving us a watch. Bye for now. This was an easy setup that I did in my dining room last spring. It was just one of those plastic shelving units. It has holes through it. I was able to hang my shop lights with zip ties. And I had the survival blankets to reflect the light back towards the plants. Here are the Brandywines. That's just a month in to show the height of those, and the grape tomatoes there. Then you'll see in a month from now when they go in to the ground how large they get in another month. I also used a timer so the lights were on at 7 in the morning and went off at 11 p.m.
Today is Monday, May 18th, and these little guys, it's time to graduate into silo cups from these little shooter cups. One thing I want to mention here is with these tomatoes, do you see how dry this is? I don't keep them wet every day. Now I was watering them every second day, but now I try to leave them every third day just to get used to being outside and not being watered every single day. Let's their roots grow deeper, etc. These little peppers. I find this a little interesting. So these are the grape tomatoes. And this is the last of the Brandywine. And just the difference of what the leaves look like. It's very interesting. Just thought I'd note that. This was the runt of the last seed that germinated from the Brandywine. These are the indeterminate grape tomatoes. And they're going to go into the silo cups today. Okay, so here all I'm doing is I have my soil in there and I'm just making sure that there's a hole in the center so that when I take the plants out of the little drink cups there, keep everything intact and just put it right in the center so that it's surrounded with new soil. Nothing's disturbed, so that it doesn't have to get used to being repotted. You just put it in there, it just has more room to grow. And then I will add more soil to go higher in these cups so that it can they can build more roots. The roots on these are really nice. Growing well. See, there's not a lot of soil in here to get these started. And these roots are not root bound at all. So you really don't need a lot to start them off. So this was an interesting morning. I have diatomaceous earth here, and then I have my neem leaves. I was trying to decide whether or not to treat the soil because we found out that we had a pest called bean seed larvae that were eating our bean seeds before they were even sprouted. And then when they did sprout, they would eat the roots of our bean plants. So I knew there was a pest in here. I just wasn't sure whether or not I needed to treat all of the soil. This morning, I was literally praying and just seeking spiritual advice whether or not I should go ahead and treat the whole bed. And this is what happened after. So here in the middle of planting my tomato plants, I discover another pest. And I could not believe I found this. Well, I was glad I found it because at least I knew they were in there. But this is a cutworm. And this is what was eating my bean plants after they were growing because they destroy the plant from the bottom of the stems, up from the roots and up the stems. So I'm looking at this and I'm shaking my head. Here it goes again, brand new soil from farmland and it's contaminated with armyworms or cutworms and bean seed larvae or corn seed larva, same thing. So the fact that I actually put the diatomaceous earth and the neem leaves in here was a true blessing to do that beforehand. It saved my garden. just, yeah. Anyways, that's what I found in the soil just now, so I am very happy that I put diatomaceous earth in here. I'll save the roots of my plants because they just eat. They'll eat all your bean seeds, they'll eat your plants from the root, and you'll wonder why your plants are dying, and your stems will all, your stems will just go to mush, and that's what cutworms do. They're horrible. All right, here I go again, taking the tomato. I'm kind of close to this one. Maybe I should go over just a little bit. I'm trying to fit as many Roma plants in as possible. I've got an excess of Roma tomatoes. These ones I had on the patio last summer, and they didn't bush out too bad. Tomatoes are my space. So here I go again. I'm supporting that back part. This is going in. I'm being covered up. And we're all set to go. Could have put that one a little bit deeper. Don't touch the stem. But oh, this is already flowering. What's going to happen is this is going to automatically grow upward to the sun. So this, all these plants that are lying down, they're just slanted in the dirt. They're going to grow upwards. You're not going to, don't touch them. Don't try to coax them to come up. Just leave them. They'll start growing up towards the sun, and then we'll be able to strap those on. For all those who are wondering, in April, there was a lot of people wondering whether or not to start seeding, starting seeds indoors in the beginning of April or the end of March, because everybody's, it's like, oh, I want a garden this year. Well, this is an example of the tomato plant that I started. This was the Brandywine. It already has flowers on it. You can see there. Already has flowers. I didn't even know it had flowers yet. This is a beefsteak. It's a determinant. And this is how large it got. So, yes. It's the 1st of June. Weekend, and beautiful plant. And here are the little Roma plants that I seeded May 17th. So they're only a couple of weeks old, and they're very small. Only two of these plants ended up surviving in the end. However, keep in mind the San Marzano tomatoes that I plant afterwards were basically this size when I plant them the week later. So here's the update on the tomatoes. These are the little Romas in the ground. Planted 10, but only 5 survived. In the end, I really only have 2 that end up continuing to produce. And there they are, just little. Anyways, these are the plants that I had laying down, and I just want to show you here that the stems are starting to grow upwards, because as I planted them just laying sideways in the soil, I want to show you how they just automatically start to grow up towards the sun. And they all go like that. They all just start standing up on their own. You don't have to bend them or support them in any way. The lower leaves on these plants actually help support the lower part of the plant. This one here was the one that I planted deep in the soil, but my soil wasn't deep enough in these gardens to really plant these tomatoes really deep. And there's clay under here. So this is what I ended up doing, just laying them down shallow and allowing them to grow up on their own. tomatoes are all supported. Going up to the trellis. Okay, and then those are the beefsteaks. These are the little Romas. Those are the two of my Romas from seed. Those seeds are from 2012. I just cleaned all the bottoms out of them. And then these are another type of Roma tomato. I'll get the name for them later. I can't remember what it is. They're supposed to be very meaty and a good... That one I supported just to get it up off the ground a little bit. They are still small. I pruned all the bottoms of them to clean them up. Straw is doing really good with keeping the leaves from getting really dirty when we water. Grape tomatoes here. Just really tall plants. At least 5 feet high now. From the level of the beds, 5.5 feet. It's above my head. But, now let's see if I can get some tomatoes there. We've already picked some that were down below and were red. So we're starting to get some for our salads. And then over here we've got the Brandywine beefsteaks. Very large plants and large tomatoes on there. There's a couple over here. These are still all Brandywine, so I'm going to pick that one. And that one over there. Bring that inside, put it on the counter because they're ready to go. We'll slice them up. So these are all the Brandywines. And then we get into, okay, these two are the Roma, the little Roma tomato plants from my 2012 seeds. And there's flowers and there's little tiny Romas on there. I'm not sure if you can see them behind there. There's one up there. Right there. So they're starting and they got flowers. And then we've got the San Marzano Romas all along here. These plants are getting very tall. And they have Roma tomatoes starting. And they're shaped different. They're a longer tomato. I'm going to try to find one here. These ones. That's a little one there. Then we have some in behind. I'm not sure if you can see in here. In there. Back there. I'm showing you here the tomatoes. And do you remember when I planted these? They were, so the stem in here, it's actually laying down. The roots are here. I lay them down and then they started growing up. This is one of the reasons why. So when I water, I just have to water this area of the garden, right in here. I don't have to water, you know, through the leaves and everything. So I could say, well, my plant roots are way back there and I've got to water on top of my tomatoes. No, I know that my roots are right here. I could go way down low and water my tomatoes just by being on the roots. Like here, again, right here, I'm actually watering my tomato, and my onions, and my marigolds. They're all important. So like the cucumbers, bring everything to the front and just water what's in the front. It's tomatoes. And here are the tomatoes. Many tomatoes in here. Lots of tomatoes that are gonna come out of here. I'm pretty sure we'll get at least a bushel. So. They're just full. Then there's the beefsteaks. Gotta pick a bunch of these today. And lots of tomatoes to pick in here. And then cherry or grape tomatoes, lots of those are all in here to pick. There's like hundreds and hundreds of grape tomatoes. Here's another 10 pounds of tomatoes getting ready to be put into bags for the freezer. It's September 19th. Southern Ontario, Saturday morning, and this is what you do when forecast calls for an early frost and you have probably a bushel of tomatoes on your plants. So this is what we did last night. Put our tomatoes to bed. Okay, we're at the end of September. Big job today, September 29th. I took all of the foliage down off of all the tomato vines. All of the ends and the tiny fruit that wouldn't mature and come to ripen shortly, took them off. This is supposed to force the plant to ripen what's on the vines. I got lots of San Marzanos here. I got beefsteaks over there. I'm picking everything that has pink on it, taking them off the vines, and gonna see how this goes. So as I was taking all the leaves off and trimming the vines, I didn't really have time to pick tomatoes at the time, so I'm doing that now. There's a lot down there, and I'm just gonna go through and remove those. So I think I may have a week left before frost comes again. So I want to get as many of these inside and ripening inside, and the plant working on what's left on the vines for the end of this year.